This is Mike Furth. I am an inker. This is a pinup for Chew that I'm doing with my friend Aris. I've worked with Aris before, and that's kind of an important thing. When you ink somebody for a while, you kind of get to know them and their style. I've had conversations with Aris about, you know, what kind of lines or things he's going for, and that way I can bring those into the inks. The first thing I always do with a page is to, as you can see, rule any straight edges. This is panel borders, things like that. I do most of my inking with a brush. The first thing I always start on a page is something that I don't care quite as much about, so I can get my brush working, my hand working, kind of, it's the equivalent of stretching. There's always something on the page that isn't quite as important, or not quite as much the focus as the rest of the page. So in this case, I'm doing this guy's beanie because I know I can do some nice big thick lines, I like thick lines, which is one reason I like a brush. When I'm doing these big black areas, I'm not gonna go in and try to get the brush to fill in all the stuff. Usually I'll outline certain parts. Here you can see I'm doing a little feathering, and then I'm gonna fill it in later, not too much later. I don't have that much self-control, but I'll do it a little bit later. Now you can see here, so for these big long lines, I'm letting my brush, you can see I'm letting it go a little bit fat because I just like it that way, but I'm gonna do the outline here, and then I make an X in the middle to remind myself later on to fill it in. Now for the contour, the outline of his beanie, Aris, I know, comes from kind of this animation school that loves those big, thick contours, so with him, I know I can go a little crazier with that. For the faces, though, what I do is I try to keep things a little bit more, my lines a little bit finer, and I also like to use the brush line for this a lot because I can do these really nice shapes with the brush, these very thin to thick lines. Brushes can do an exceedingly very thin line, which gives it very sharp edges. So you can go really thin with the edge and then go really thick in the middle of a line. So here for the face, what I'm doing a lot is, if you look at my hand, I use my left hand as kind of a brace. So my right hand, I just put the edge of my thumb right on there, and it helps me get slightly smoother lines, or at least I think so. I'm sure there are some guys who can just do this without that, but I find for me, having my left hand there just makes my lines just that much smoother. I read once in a book with Mark Farmer, who's an inker and who's worked with Alan Davis a lot, who has these very, very wonderful, beautiful lines, a lot of detail work, that Alan told him that as long as he got the faces right, Alan didn't care so much about the rest of it. And while I don't exactly prescribe to that exactly, I do pay a lot of attention to my faces and try to really make those sing the best I can. As you can see here, I'm trying to put in a lot of little tiny lines there, and the brush is great for that because even I'm using a number 3, and even the number 3, which is a little bit thicker than some people use, still gives you a really thick line. A really thin line and a really thick line. So you get the best of both worlds, and since it's a bit larger, you have a little bit more ink in your brush, which means you don't have to stop as often, so you can keep going. Now, like I mentioned before, Aris likes some big, bold contours to hold his characters in, and what I find a lot with inking him is that I end up having to go over my contours because they're not beefy enough. Even my initial line that I put down isn't quite thick enough. Now I could just make it thicker right off the get-go, but then I would lose a little bit of the exact expression that he's using with his pencil that he's making. So what I often find is that I go over it once, you can see, and then I have to go over it a little bit again just to beef up that contour and make it the way Aris likes it. Now, I remember when I was first starting to ink, I was really intimidated by long lines, long interrupted, especially with the cleaner pencilers who don't put as much detail down. You really have to get those lines right. I found that really the only thing that made my lines straighter was getting used to it and having that confidence. Now here, I'm doing some detail work, and one thing I want to point out is that the brush has a lot of movement to it. So you can see I'm making these little circles on the knuckle, and it's kind of an uninterrupted line from the brush. That brush can kind of bend in on itself a little bit. With the cleaner styles, it sometimes doesn't give you as clean a line, but you can still get a fairly clean line when you're moving the brush in a circle. Pens can't do that quite as well. They kind of go in one straight line. Now for the face, again here, it's looking like my hand's not moving too much because I'm trying to get these really, really tiny lines in there. I'm trying to be really exact with what I'm doing. I do spin the page quite a lot. I know some inkers don't have to spin the page, but my arm, I'm just kind of going in a more or less up and downwards motion, so I keep shifting the page around to make sure that my hand is just going in a fairly straight line and that my lines are going in the right direction. Like I said, some inkers don't have to do this. I do. Now I've got out my pen. I've done most of the work on the page. I bring out the pen because there's definitely some lines that when I look at Aris's work, I feel that they just need to be nice and thin, thin lines. A little bit more consistent than I would get normally with a brush. It's just a little faster to grab out one of these dip pens. Now this particular nib I'm using is a newer nib, and it hasn't really broken in yet, so you can see I'm having a little bit of trouble with that. The pen also gives me, I like some of the textures that I can get with a pen. When you have that little metal nib, it just gives you different textures than a brush. And here you can see I'm going to use that here where I'm just going to like maybe little sharp movements with the pen back and forth to give a different texture for these parts of his pants, for his pockets. This particular nib is a Japanese nib, and it's really stiff, which means it's really good at thin lines. There are nibs that give you a greater variation of line, but I go for this thin one because I can get the thick lines with my brush. I need something that's going to give me the detail work. Here I brought out my French curve with my pen so I can get, like I said, really thin lines here for his hair, but I can use the French curve to get very exact. These I don't want to be quite as organic, I want them to be a little bit more exact, so I got the French curve out. Now I have my circle template. I'm using a micron marker. I used to use rapidographs a lot, but since I don't ink as consistently as I would like to, those tend to clog up. You need a lot of maintenance on those. The markers, you know, they're really good. They do wear in a little bit, so they're not going to give you as exactly flat a line as the rapidographs did, but I like them because they're disposable, they're cheap, and they work kind of like a rapidograph. Sometimes I actually like it. I know there are artists like Frank Cho who use these a lot because they can give a slightly varied line. Once the felt tip breaks in a little bit, you get a little bit of variation to your line, which actually helps out a little bit. I don't always want a simply flat line, meaning there's no variation to it. That's just one width the whole way through. Here I've swapped out for a much thicker micron, and what I'm using is this flexi ruler thing, so I can get a custom line. I tend to go for the inorganic things. I'll use these flatter lines Here on the gun, I'm doing that entirely with these micron markers. Sometimes I'll go over them here, as you can see, to get some of that line variation for shadows. But they're really good for inorganic things where you need it to be not as alive as a brush or a pen will give you. Now I've swapped back to the pen, and you can see I'm trying to get that nib to work right. I'll just draw a little bit right on the drawing board to make sure that the nib's working right. And now I've got my French curve out again, and I'm doing these special things in the background that I want to make sure that it's really super controlled and super even. But I do need a slight line variation, so I've gone back to the dip pen to get that. Here I've gone back to a brush, but it's actually a different brush. Brushes you need to break in a little bit. This brush I ordered off the internet, and it's not working out quite as well as I had hoped. So I'm hoping that by using it a little bit, by building up a little bit of ink in the brush, because there's always a little bit of ink that you can never get out of a brush after you clean it, that'll tighten up the point and get a little bit finer. But actually, after I was inking this page, I kind of gave up on it, and now I'm just going to use that to fill in blacks. Now I've switched over to some white paint. I always have to use a little bit of gouache at the end, a little bit of white out. Here I wasn't happy with this particular line on his hair. I needed it to be really fine, so I went over it once more. Here I'm doing a little effect to make sure that the rope on his neck pops out a little bit. So I'm using the white paint for that. Then the last thing I always do is put my name in there. It's kind of a thing. I'd never do it before I finished a page. I feel like it's kind of bad luck. And there we go.